Well, here comes the rain again. Just as I was coming outside here to tape, it starts coming down and it's cold, and I shouldn't be out here because I have the flu. But I just have to share the good news, the gospel with y'all. Absolutely. Because there's too much great stuff going on. Last night, greatest night of my life, the greatest experience of my life. It was just, I don't, what can I say? Amazing. Absolutely amazing. So, what we want to talk first about is to share this information about how desperation is God's opportunity. So I hit a wall of desperation last night, but I didn't. I was on the edge of, going into frustration and bitterness, etc. But I said, no, let's be patient, and it was right on the edge. So it's very important when you're desperate to see it as an opportunity, that God is just blocking everything, so you focus on what the best thing possible is. And that's what happened with me. That is exactly what happened. So there's some of us that get this, that we think, oh, I'm sick. Everything's, my life's falling apart. I can't do this. I can't do this. There's nothing for me. It was just, I can't do anything. God blocked everything. And I'm just sitting there in a chair saying, I got nothing to do. God doesn't want me to do this. Just life is in absolute ruins. Plus, I feel like I've been run over by a truck. And I said, okay, what do I need to do? And somehow it came to me what to do. Somehow it came to me what to do. And I started doing it. You could call it a meditation. And so I just started this meditation. I need to calm down because I can't remember what it was right now. Yeah, there's too much activity right now. Okay, there you go. It just shows you that how our attention can get too agitated, and we need to calm down. So it's a, I am an apex yogin. I am an apex yogin. Wow. That's all I said. I am an apex yogin. Wow. Okay, that's it. I am an apex yogin. Wow. I am an apex yogin. Wow. So I've been sleeping all day. I was just so sick and tired, and I went to bed about 11:30 or so, and just I said, "Well, I'm probably not going to sleep because I've been sleeping all day, so let me just start this meditation." And it just came to me, just say this. I started saying it. I said, "I'm just going to. I got nothing else to do. I really had nothing else to do. I couldn't look at the internet. I couldn't go anywhere. It was literally my whole life had been narrowed down to." There's only one thing I can do, and that is just to say, well, I am an apex yogin. Wow. That's all that I had left in my life. And so I said, well, instead of like cursing God, I said, might as well use what I have left. That's what I had left. So I started utilizing this. As we say, our extremity is God's opportunity. So God will box us into a corner somehow. So, and that's an opportunity for God to have us apply what we have left. And it turns out to be the real key. We're just not using the key. So this then began the most amazing journey of my life for sure. As I began to say this over and over, I said, "Oh, I got nothing else to do in the world. Might as well be good at this. So let me be really good at this. I'm just going to keep saying it. I am an apex yogin. Wow. I am an apex yogin. Wow. I am an apex yogin. Wow." And so I just kept stringing these together like this. So I wanted to just keep repeating it. As soon as I finished repeating it, I'd say it again and then again. And I just kept doing it. That's all. That's fun. I said, "Oh, this is nice." Then I started suddenly recognize, wait, I forgot. And I go ahead, pull myself back to it. And I kept doing this throughout the night. I would doze off for a while and then wake up, doze off. So all night long I did this with periods of dozing. And truly, it became extraordinary and virtually inexplicable, really. Virtually inexplicable. We won't struggle trying to explain. It was enough of a struggle to do it. but the cleverness of the mind, you might say, the ocean of samsara, the storylines, the cleverness of how it tried to suck me into stopping this and following some storyline, some drama in my mind was amazing. Now, I had experienced this once before, but this time it was much, much more clearly experienced. And I had like maybe at least two massive meditations during the night, like 3 hours each, you know, of doing this, and then smaller phases too. So it's just, you know, tremendous prolonged meditation. And so I was able to experience this for myself, the astonishing cleverness of our imagination, of how it would introduce all these storylines to me, all these adventures to distract me away from saying I am an apex yogin. Wow. And yet I was able to just go right back to saying it without fighting, without struggling. I just start saying it and it would dissolve. This whole storyline would dissolve. And so the whole night I was spent with this play of creativity that was just astonishing. Like the ocean of samsara was trying to pull me back and say, turn around and go back into the ocean. And I said, no, I'm headed for safe harbor, safe refuge. And I just kept my sights on the safe refuge. I am an apex yogin. Wow. I am an apex yogin. Wow. So I was able to go through this experience. I would say successfully. I didn't have any success in mind because that's a storyline too. I just said, I am an apex yogin, wow. That's all I did, just I am an apex yogin, wow. And just kept my attention on this. Just repeating it. Not trying to understand anything, okay. But I certainly experienced all this interference, the siren songs of the ocean of samsara, as it tried to lull me and seduce me and interest me in every guise, so many guises, to go back into the storylines and lose my awareness that I'm an apex yogin. An apex yogin. Wow is the storyline of an apex yogin. Just wow. See, I'm an apex yogin. Wow is my storyline. And that's it. So I cut everything else off. An apex yogin is that taking the position of no gradual progress, no time, space, process, or form storyline at all. Okay. Inherently above all that. So you take the position of beyond all that already, not having to get beyond it, inherently beyond it. So I am an apex yogin. Taking the position of I don't need any gradual efforts of progression. I don't need to struggle with any storyline at all. Okay, my storyline is just wow, that's it. So then I am an apex yogin, wow. That's it, that says it all. So I'm like above the clouds, above the ocean of samsara. I'm not in it. And yet, the calls that it made to me. But I was very calm and so desperate that I was just said, I have to succeed at this. I'm at a point of such desperation in my life. I said, I have to succeed at this. There's no two ways about it. And so I just calmly kept at it all night, all night, all night. Refused to get frustrated. I never got frustrated. I never panicked. I just said that, you know, I'm doing this because this is all I have to do. There's nothing else for me to do. So that's it. I finally got out of bed about almost 11 o'clock in the morning, and the intensity then dropped away as you're going about your business. During the daytime, it's quite difficult to tune in like I did in the nighttime, where I was just absolutely 100% focused on it. So what an experience. What an experience. That I wouldn't have done. No one's going to do what I just did unless they're really desperate, in my opinion. God blocked everything except this. To take this position, I'm an apex yogin. That's it. Wow. And just no matter what arises, I just go right, just keep saying that. I'm an apex yogin. Wow. I'm an apex yogin. Wow. I'm an apex yogin. Wow. Now, you might do this for like 10 minutes or 20 minutes and see, oh, nothing's really interfering. Okay, I did it. Try doing it all night. Then you start finding out that the interferences start arising subtly, cleverly. They'll let you do it. The ego will let you practice for a little while and won't interfere, okay? But when you insist that this is it and I'm not backing away from this ever again, that's when the call back to the ocean of samsara, all the imaginary insane storylines begin to then arise and say, you got to come back here, that you need this. It's like, are you all right? I think you need this kind of thing. So meditating for 10, 20 minutes, or even an hour, that's not where it's at, actually. And this is what I discovered. Again, the ego, our delusion of doubt doesn't really mind if you meditate for a little while. It'll let you do that for a lifetime. So you're still okay, I'm calm, peaceful, meditate for a while. And you say, oh, okay, that was enjoyable. I feel a little more relaxed and calm. But it's when you say, I'm not stopping this from now on. This is I'm going to be saying this for the rest of my life. Okay, and here we go. And the ego, of course, laughs at you and says, oh, yeah, you won't do that. So it lets you do it for a while. But then as you keep going, it gets worried and says, hey, wait a minute. What if this is serious? And say, wait, I think there's something wrong with you. You need to get away from that. And that's when it starts jumping in. So you don't really meditate until you really meditate like all night like this, or all, you know, for a long time, and just say, I'm not stopping, I'm just going to keep doing this. That's when this play of interference then begins to arise and becomes more and more ingenious, and you see the astonishing creativity of our imagination, how you just move past one attempt. And you just, I'm an apex yogin, wow. I'm an apex yogin, wow. And then it's gone. And you're not looking back. You never look back. You just say, I'm an apex yogin, wow. That's it. You don't look forward. You don't look back. You're just stating what you are. And then before you know it, you've forgotten suddenly. And this incredible drama and storyline and has arisen out of nowhere. It's like, to snare you, you know, and then you go back, I'm an apex yogin, wow, I'm an apex yogin, wow, I'm an apex yogin, wow. I'm an Apex Yogin. Wow. And it fades away. You don't try to make it fade away. You just focus on I'm an Apex Yogin. Wow. Back to your purpose. Stating what you really are. That's it. You just keep stating what you really are. You do not grapple or struggle with anything. You just turn your attention back to I am an Apex Yogin. Wow. Or you, if you're a woman, you say, I'm an Apex Yogini. Wow. I am an Apex Yogini. Wow. Okay? Or yoga, and if you like, just a neutral term, that's fine. Whatever, either way is fine. And you don't anticipate the next struggle. You say, it doesn't matter. Whatever arises, doesn't matter. I'm still going to affirm this. It doesn't matter what arises. I don't care. I'm not going to be knocked off of this no matter what happens. The whole world could burst into flame. I'm still going to say, I'm an Apex Yogin. Wow. I'm an Apex Yogin. Wow. I'm an Apex Yogin. Wow. Determine that that is all you're going to assert or pay attention to. So I don't have time to engage any of these storylines anymore. You know, and you're desperate. You just cannot. It doesn't matter what arises. I'm going to stick with I'm an Apex Yogin. That's it. Wow. Longchenpa, I got up yesterday morning, and Lotsaba House had a post on Facebook of this short, like 6-7 line post about from Longchenpa, with a beautiful picture of him in a Tonka Tibetan depiction. And I said, that's not very Longchenpa-esque, really. I was gonna make a comment like, I don't know if this is really from Longchenpa, but it basically said, look. Turn your mind away, discard the world's opinions of you, refuse to listen to any blame or praise, and like they were just faint echoes that were hardly meaningless, and be very patient enduring all this, and then turn to the mind and cut the mind off at its root. Cut the mind off at its root. So don't be following anything what the world says about you, one way or the other. Let it be very faint to you, and just put all your attention on cutting the mind off at its root, what's really the ocean of samsara, the ocean of doubt, doubting what we are. And at first I said, wow, I can't be Longchenpa. That sounds like Tibetan boilerplate. But then finally later on in the day, I said, well, maybe that's what he wants me to do. And so it turns out that that's exactly the advice that I did. The meditation was, I am an Apex Yogin. Wow. And that's all I did. And it's like cutting the mind off at its root and not paying any attention to the praise or blame. Because the stuff that storylines that come up are both negative and positive. And they try to say, oh, here's a storyline where you're full of be praised in so many ways. And here's a storyline where you'll be criticized. You're being criticized in so many ways, like you're supposed to respond to the criticism or something, or enjoy the praise. I was having none of it. So I did a Longchenpa, I followed Longchenpa's advice and did an Apex Yoga meditation right there. It's very strong shorthand to use, but I was able to get it and do it. But I never would have done it without the grace of God blocking everything else in my life and making me very desperate. And then I took it in the right way. I even had the flu. So it's great, because all I could do the last couple of days, just lie and sleep all day, kind of. I did work Friday, but Friday afternoon, I just slept, and then Friday night, slept, and all day Saturday, I'm just sleeping all day. And during the day, I was practicing kind of also. So I was in this mood of like just lying there all day, just kind of sleeping. I said, what the heck? And plus it helped me then stay up all night kind of dozing on and off and do this. So the flu turned out to be the final helpful straw. And this morning I feel better, amazingly enough. My body doesn't feel like I've been run over by a truck. And I just feel all around, I feel a little better. And I did feed the flu. I did eat a lot yesterday, which I think kept my strength up, which was a good move. I was thinking maybe I can use the sickness just to not eat anything and lose a lot of weight, but I was so hungry. I said, "No, that let me keep my strength going." So, but you see how when you get sick, I always say sickness and poverty is God's greatest blessing. That he and God has blocked so much in my life, not blocked me from doing just about everything in my life, and he finally blocked me to the point where that all I could do was meditate. I couldn't do anything else. Literally, it's amazing. That's a great, great, great benefit. Great benefit. So don't get mad at your life if things tend think you're going, "Oh, I can't do this now. I can't do this. I can't do this." That's the grace of God at work, because ultimately, what God is doing is bringing us to liberating us from all these storylines of doubt. Useless storylines. All flights of fancy, whimsical fancy, of doubting that we are what we truly are. And I could see how my life has just been immersed in this ocean of samsara, and how the mind is constantly at play in this way, just baffling all of us, and how meditation has to be used like this, how the skillful means have to be used. Otherwise, if we struggle with these storylines, we don't have a prayer. Because as we're struggling with one storyline, guess what? There are infinite other ones waiting to snare us. There's no end to them. The mind is so creative. So we'll spend a whole lifetime struggling with a storyline and think, "Well, we got somewhere." There's endless storylines that will then, the next one will just snare you, just the same easy way as the first, as the one you just been struggling with snared you. So that's absolutely futile to approach the situation in such a way of trying to do good with a certain storyline, imaginary storyline. That won't get it done. It will not get it done. That's why some say, "Well, you know, it's going to take you millions of lives to get free." No. After a million lives, there's a million. After a million storylines, episodes of doubt, there'll be a million more, and a million. The mind never runs out of creativity, never runs out of creativity at all. Nor does its creativity get weakened really at all. So that's why we have to cut it off at the root, cut doubt off at the root by stating what we really are. Don't struggle with doubt. Doubt cannot heal doubt. Okay? Can doubt get rid of doubt? Can doubt get rid of doubt? Now, I didn't tape yesterday. I apologize for that because I was just too sick, and it was late at night. It was super cold out. I was just shivering. I would have gotten really ill if I went out. Today it's cool. It's on the cool side here. I noticed that, like in the United States at least, I know there are viewers from all over the globe, but the U.S. it's springtime. I was looking like Chicago's like 70 degrees. I mean, what? We're like low 50s here in California, and we're about ready to get hammered by another massive storm. I mean, this is just amazing. 3 to 5 inches in this area. 3 to 5 inches is coming starting about 4 o'clock this Sunday afternoon, roaring through Monday into the late Monday with high winds. I mean, we get one of these every 4 or 5 days. So this is the calm before the storm. We just got a little shower there, but by all accounts, flash flood warnings everywhere. It's just going to be another deluge. How many have we had? I've lost track. And I'm sure the river will be, really high, and the reservoir is high, and they've been letting water out as fast as possible to. So they can, they realize it's going to be massive runoff coming again. Possible flooding in the state, all over the state. Interesting. I had that dream of flooding back in before any of this happened in California. Just all this water, massive amounts of water and flooding. And it seems to be coming true. We hope it's none of it comes true, and it all we all get through it. And I feel we will. I feel we will. I feel we will. But it should be interesting. We just getting used to it. This enjoying this winter in California, which is it's very nice. Love it. And so we'll get through this one, and then see what comes next, just like that. And what are we going towards the last part of February already? 28 days, and then zooming into March before we know it. And most of the country's having springtime, early spring for everyone. But we'll take another month or two of rain here, actually. Absolutely. It all just goes back to the ocean anyway, pretty much, right? So, I mean, ocean is not going to lose anything by dumping water on us. Might as well dump water on us. Oh, eventually it makes its way back to the ocean. So, calm before the storm here. And we're getting used to this exercise, and it's all working out great. And hopefully, my health picks up. It feels like somehow I turned a corner in some way. But again, the most fortuitous flu ever. The most fortuitous flu ever. And I wonder, why did I get this? I said, I don't get sick. This is very odd. I couldn't understand it. I said, I should be able to just push this aside, but I'm not able. And says, wow, okay, so what, why, what is this for? What is this for? I didn't get upset and just stayed optimistic. Okay, let's see what this is for. Well, ultimately, it became the most fortuitous flu ever. Set it all up for me. I had the perfect excuse. I'm tired. I gotta rest all day. I gotta just lie here. And today too, I just, I still feel tired, but I've got an excuse. I just gotta take it easy and rest. I am an apex yogin. Wow. I am an apex yogin. Wow. Now, I don't know what the overall effectiveness of it was, except certainly I found out I could do this. And it certainly showed me that this is what has been done before. Others have done this. And so I was really into this very intense meditation. So I know that it is going to bear fruit. It will bear fruit, and is a very helpful step to take. But I'm not trying to assess any results. Remember, just wow. There's not a storyline of results that I'm trying to imagine at all. That's very important. Don't try to imagine any results from this. Just keep doing it. Now, you might not do it right now because, like I said, I wouldn't have done it except for extreme desperation. The times when I made the most progress has been from extreme desperation, where I realized I got no choice. I have to give it just, cut to the chase immediately right here, right? And I'm still in extreme desperation. So, but if you're not in extreme desperation, you might not do it. I understand that. You might try it for 10 minutes. Say, oh, okay, I could do it for 10 minutes. But this again was, okay, this is what I'm going to be doing. And nothing else. Nothing else. I don't have anything else to do in the world except this. That's literally how I felt. So I might as well give it my full attention and full effort. And I have to succeed in some measure. This is now my life. I have to succeed at it. So it put a whole different spin on it. And without that spin, it's not going to be the same experience. You can get a little bit if you want. If you really make an effort, you can experience some of it, yeah. But then you might say, whoa, I don't know. What if it gets even more intense? What's going to happen? But for me, I said, bring it on. I mean, I said, whatever arises doesn't matter. And I wasn't scared at all. I was very calm. I never got rattled at all. It's amazing how my mind just stayed calm and focused. I didn't judge any storyline that arose. I just didn't judge it. Just right back to I am an apex yogin. Wow. And I really believe it. I am an apex yogin. I believe that. It is true. I am an apex yogin. And so I said, that's what I am. I'm not all this other stuff. It's got nothing to do with me. I'm an apex yogin. I can't be touched by this stuff. And I just didn't get worried or panicked or anything like that. So it is possible. It is absolutely possible to do this. But there might be some of you who find yourself getting pushed into sort of a desperate corner. So this is important to hear this and get this reassurance. It may be in the future here, there's going to be a lot of desperation, actually, which is a good thing. Very good. Very great. Now, do I need to stay desperate? I don't know. I feel now like I know I can do this and I enjoy doing it and it's something that I can do. So maybe at some point I won't need to be in such dire circumstances in order to do it. But to get it going, it was vital that the circumstances be so dire. But then maybe you can ease off, and I will still be focused on this. Just had to get it started, get it rolling. It seemed to have. Something profound seemed to be in some way taking place. Like I was losing interest in all these storylines. So I do feel it was beneficial, but it was nothing I could measure, put my finger on, or anything like that. I just said, look, I'll just keep doing that. I'm going to keep doing this no matter what arises, whether it's I'm successful or not. I'm still going to do this. This is what I can do. That's it. So let's just do it. I am an apex yogin. Wow. I am an apex yogin. Wow. I am an apex yogin. Wow. So, apex yoga means I'm above all paths, all progressions, all storylines. They really have nothing to do with what I am. So it's the yoga of just emphasizing this fact. It's simply the yoga of emphasizing this fact. There are no storylines to my identity. I'm not in doubt. What I am is not in doubt in the slightest bit. that everything is simultaneous with me. There's nothing to arrive at. There's nothing to arrive at. Everything is pre-arrived. All is pre-arrived. One way of saying preordained, but I think pre-arrived I like better. Preordained sounds like fate, but the same, it's getting to the same issue. Everything is pre-arrived at. There's no sense of an arrival at anything. It's pre-arrived. So all experiencing in reality is pre-arrived, like, well, we can't even express it in words, can we? I just, pre-arrived is the only one I can say. Preordained, pre-arrived. This feeling like it's all preordained. Whatever happens, it seems like it was completely preordained to happen. And there's, you know, it's that feeling of reality is all preordained. But it doesn't mean that you don't have free will. I don't think that's the meaning that we're having. So I like pre-arrived gets away from this fate or destiny kind of notion. So like normally when we go somewhere, we arrive, we get this feeling like, well, I arrived here because there was a journey to get there, right? Arrival means I came from somewhere to get there. But in reality, there's not that feeling at all. Everything is pre-arrived at. In other words, it's all completely spontaneous, this feeling of pre-arrivedness. So there's no storyline feeling at all. No feeling of this. I don't like the term I. It's been overused. It's just no. It's fine to use the term I. There's no problem with it. That's just a pointer. But it's been. We get so tripped up on it. I don't like using it to explain stuff. I like the term pre-arrived. Everything is every experience we have. If we feel like it's pre-arrived. Like, you know, it's always been this way. It's always been this way. But again, we can't really explain it, but pre-arrived is just a way of kind of pointing to it. We'd use the term déjà vu is a term, this feeling like, hasn't this already happened? I mean, it feels like this is already just like, I know it's going to happen. I know what's, you know, I just feel so comfortable, like it's already been experienced in some way. And I'm just experiencing it now, but it doesn't seem like it seems so comfortable to me. And I know this is how it all goes. Déjà vu, like that. So everything is déjà vu. All pre-arrived. Everything is already pre-arrived. All déjà vu. There's nothing that feels foreign to us at all. So there's no doubt It's like there's no doubt that this is what I want to be experiencing. There's no doubt at all. And I didn't come from someplace else looking for this experience and trying to get away from some other experience. No. The experience I had before was also exactly what I wanted to experience. There's no doubt about that either. So everything has this feeling of pre-arrivedness. It's just one way to kind of shift our way of look, flip the script, sort of. Pre-arrived. Just let this shake you up. Don't try to intellectualize it, because then the effect is lost. It's just designed to give this effect like, wow, I pre-arrived, wow. I feel it shaking me up. Don't intellectualize it. Just feel it. Don't conceptualize or intellectualize. Just feel the shake-up, the wow of it. Wow. I'm an apex yogin, wow. I am an apex yogin, wow. Longchenpa teaches this from the standpoint of an apex yogin. His teaching is from that standpoint. Very strongly. Other teachings move us towards that. At its root, they're that way. But Longchenpa's teachings seem to be just so potently that way without anything else. Yeah, just really very clearly that way. There were a lot of meditators in Tibet, genuine meditators throughout history. Something about the isolation of the country, the simplicity, the non-industrialized nature of the place, the many caves, just the how easy it was to retreat into a cave in wintertime. There's nothing so cold, and you have your barley flour and your ghee butter and a little fire, and what there's nothing else to do, is might as well meditate. So close your eyes and forget about night and day in a cave. You don't worry about night and day. You doze, and you meditate, you doze, you meditate, you doze, you meditate. You might, you do that, and you just might get into that habit of just doing it all the time for years and years and years and years. That's very possible, right? So then you become extremely familiar with the landscape of the mind. So Longchenpa speaks in shorthand to those who, are very, very familiar enough to get what he's talking about. The shorthand, it's like, oh, okay, I get it. But here, with the distractions that we have now, this world now, it's horrible. It's extremely difficult to meditate anymore. Most of us, for stress reduction, the meditation that's being taught is, just calm yourself down at the end of the day. Deep breaths, relax the body. I'm nice floating down a nice peaceful river. Listen, the birds are chirping. I'm listening to some beautiful music. I'm just feeling calm and relaxed and peaceful. And just imagine that you're, you know, like this. Oh, okay, that's nice. Okay, that's a different type. It's not what Lung Jump was getting at. That's just stress reduction. So you can then frantically pursue your storyline, success in your storyline, the next day. What Apex Yoga does is again it goes to the root. Cut it off at the root. Pull it up by the roots. You're a priori already free. Refuse to surrender this fact. These are just imaginary storylines of doubt. But we don't have to engage with any of those. Doubt will never remove doubt. Once you accept doubt, a storyline of doubt, what can you do except exchange it for another storyline of doubt, thinking that that one, different labels would make a difference of doubt. Labeling doubt with different labels, how does that cure doubt? So there are infinite efforts in the sea of samsara of doubt. To struggle with doubt and try to purify a storyline or try to make it better. Infinite ways of efforts, but none of them can possibly succeed to liberate you from all storylines of doubt, right? So you find you get another one and another one. And at some point you say, man, I'm tired of these. Something, you know, I feel like this can go on forever. Well, it can if we let it. And then you wonder, well, how can I possibly succeed? It's very, I don't understand, and it's very difficult to understand. As long as you're trying to use doubt to free you from doubt, it seems very doubtful that it will succeed. And with good reason, because it won't. It won't. But as you keep trying different ways to succeed and keep failing, then you say, wait a minute, I've tried that way. I've tried this. This doesn't work. And so you keep looking for what works. And so ultimately all your failures help move you towards success just out of extreme frustration and desperation. You say, I have to help. This isn't working. So we have some help here. We have some help here, which is a fabulous treasure, fabulous treasure. Very auspicious, fabulous treasure. So successful meditation was undertaken last night in this world, right in the midst of, we're in the Silicon Valley here, right in the midst of all of the massive distraction that we're putting up. We're saying, hey, look, you have endless storylines you could follow. You're so wealthy. Look at all these storylines of doubt you can follow. Every day there's a million more, and we'll produce billions more for you. And we're thinking, oh my gosh, we live in a cornucopia of possibilities. And we're thinking we're so wealthy. But each one of those storylines gets really stormy. At some point, it may start out looking intriguing, but it's got nowhere to go except extremely stormy. And then when it gets extremely stormy, you scream help, help, and then you grab another story, one that line that seems to start out nicely. You say, oh man, this is better. And then it gets extremely stormy as well, because conflict is inherent within any doubt. Any storyline of doubt has conflict at its root. The mind is conflicted between doubt and truth, because doubt is doubting truth, that truth is true. But since we are, truth is true, and we are reality, the truth of reality, that stays with us. We remain as an idea in the mind of God, and so something within us, you know, we try to doubt it, and there's a conflict then. The part of the mind that's doubting itself. The mind that's doubting itself feels kind of split. Like there's part of the mind that doubts the mind, there's part that doesn't. And there's a fear of being overwhelmed by truth. Doubt fears being overwhelmed. Because it thinks that it has to somehow, its storylines have to work out. And it'd be overwhelming to have them all work out quickly. But none of them have to work out. We don't have to succeed at any storyline. We just have to realize that none of those are what I am. I'm already totally pre-arrived. So there was no, I didn't have any feeling of being overwhelmed at all. I'm just focused. I'm already pre-arrived. I'm already pre-arrived. So how can I be overwhelmed if I'm already pre-arrived? There can't be any overwhelmingness then. Already pre-arrived. Doubt thinks it has to integrate all its storylines and said, oh my gosh, truth is knocking. I gotta hurry up and integrate all these. And then it says, oh, I'm overwhelmed. It's too much work. How can I integrate all these completely crazy, weird, bizarre storylines? Nothing needs to be integrated. We're already totally pre-arrived with no storylines. We're never absent from this pre-arrivedness. So we can never foster a storyline to our experiencing. It's not a storyline. It's a flow of being, a pre-arrived beingness. So this is very intense. I'm in the wow now. It's like, wow, this is great information. But I said, Longchenpa, help your apex yoga meditators. Help your apex yoga meditators. It's very, very, very important the apex yoga meditators be kept viable here in this world to help out. So I said, help us out. Now, I'm an apex yoga meditator. Now, I've done it from the apex standpoint. I've done a powerful meditation, so I know I can do it. That means I'm an apex yoga meditator. What does that mean in terms of help? I don't know. I really don't know. But I said, Longchenpa, help, you know. Support your apex yoga meditators. Support your apex yoga meditators. So, reasonable to expect that he will do just that. But the Longchenpan array, which includes a vast array, Padmasambhava, Manjushri, the whole Nyingma lineage, all Tibetan Buddhism in various ways, Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodro, all the Bodhisattvas. I mean, it's just a vast array, the Longchenpan array, the apex yoga array. I call upon the Apex Yoga Array to support your Apex Yoga meditators. Truly. And I feel they will. My knee even felt better today. It felt terrible yesterday. I said, wow. Everything felt terrible. I want to be spry and jumping around here going into spring. Be spry for spring. So the knee needs to get its game on. Be spry for spring. So as far as like working out, that's a good mantra right there. Let me be spry for spring. Spry for spring. So I believe I'm going to need to do, you know, some workouts that along those lines, so I'm able to be very spry, nimble, quick, spry, nimble, quick, spry, nimble, quick. I've done a lot of weight work, heavy weight work, or not heavy, but a lot of, I think I need to now shift to spry, nimble, quick, spry, nimble, quick. But the knee has to cooperate for that, because that requires a lot of, puts a lot of pressure on the knees to do that, to be hopping sideways and backwards and this way and that way. Spry, nimble, quick for spring. Be spry for spring. Be loose and flexible and spry. So it's time to start that. Workout, great. Have great workouts, have great nutrition, and do great Apex yoga meditation. That's what Apex yoga is about. Apex yoga, have great workouts, have great nutrition, and have great meditation. Apex yoga meditation. So the workout part of it, I think it's to be spry for spring. That means, you know, for me, I really start running backwards again, start skipping, start, which I was really into last year and just had a great time. I remember the best I've ever felt was being real spry and just being able to just move so easily and glide around. That was so great. And with my knee issue, I haven't been able to do that anymore. And so I've been working more on my core and getting stronger that way. I'll keep doing that, but now it's time to start skipping around, skipping and hopping around. I was even listening to some disco last night. maybe it's time to start twirling and dancing along, really. Don't be all muscle bound. As you come out of winter, we start getting flexible, all right? Flexible for the summer. So we'll have a flexible summer. Have a spry spring leading to a flexible summer. Something like that. A supple summer. Yeah, a supple summer. A spry spring and a supple summer. Winter's the time to, I think, do the heavy workouts and get the core strength there, which I'm super sore. I overdid it because I realized I better hurry up. But wow, I'm just, I'm gonna have to give it a little bit of rest and do some other types of stuff. Now, if you're sick, that's a blessing right now, actually. It gives you an excuse to meditate a lot, which is very, 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 very key and helpful. You don't want to be too active, where you just do all this stuff, constantly on the go, which is a Silicon Valley lifestyle. I mean, it's just frantic. People are just frantic. They're so frantic that they don't even stop at stop signs and stoplights anymore. You just, no, I'm too frantic. You see these people, they're just like monsters, frantic freaks, driving like maniacs. They go into full frantic mode and they just can't stop. Well, it's so expensive to live here, to rent, to function. It's nuts. So you don't want to be that way. Blessed are the poor in spirit, Jesus said. They shall inherit the kingdom. Wow, that is so true. That is so true. When everything is blocked, you turn within and you say, well, I can do this one thing with my mind. I can meditate like this. So make the most of it. I tried swinging a stick to simulate a golf club, and you can hear it, whoosh, you can hear the sound of it so nicely, whoosh, whoosh, you know, how fast it goes. And then I tried swing like I'm a real strong person. All my muscles are tense and strong. I'm like this, like I'm really hitting something that weighs 10 pounds. And it was so slow. The sound was just so, I said, oh my gosh. And then I tried to be real loosey-goosey and relaxed, like a rag doll kind of thing, and then swang that, and just whoosh, so fast, so fast. So it's the relaxed, hinged, quick movements and not the powerful tensed-up movements that make for a really fast swing. So that's what I'm gravitating towards that now. I realize that, yeah, the core is very important to stabilize everything, but it's also really important to be very relaxed and supple, very relaxed and supple, and quick, spry, be very spry, nimble, flexible, quick. So again, if you're desperate, say, God, good, good, good. What does God want me to do? How is God getting my attention? So there's no time for anyone to panic. And again, I'm still desperate, so yeah, I need to get on to the next. What is the next step here? Just fast, fast. Again, I have a little bit of confidence. And we'll see how far that goes. A little bit of confidence can probably go a long ways. That Longchenpa's meditation works. I'm an apex yogin. Wow. Full stop in the wow works. Using the wow works, it's a combination of those approaches. I am an apex yogin. Wow. It really, really, really works. So, and if he has other suggestions, I have confidence that I can try those. They will work also. That they're easy, they're simple, they work. So we got something going here. We have some momentum now. We have some momentum, which is what we need. It feels right, doesn't it? To start with momentum at this point, it's just perfect. What is today? I think it's like the 19th and 19th of February. It's a great time to have some momentum. It's been like 1 month now, actually, of the new presidency in the United States. So it's an interesting milestone, isn't it? Very interesting milestone. I haven't paid any attention to what's going on at all. But as I said, I would you know, stay out of it. Of course, other people around me occasionally say stuff, and people are becoming very hysterical, you know. Which I do. I know it's going to, all this stuff's going to happen, but I don't need to pay any attention to it. The polarization is going to get more and more extreme. You know, it's just going to be crazy, to say the least. And you know, however which way you want to look at it, these are the times that try our souls, right? For sure. So as it's been 1 month, the inauguration day was the 19th of January. So the first month, isn't that amazing? And in that 1 month, we have been able to get a toehold, to get some momentum with Longchenpa, the Longchenpa array. The Longchenpa Alpha, Longchenpa Apex Array, the Longchenpa Apex Array, Longchenpa Apex Array. The Apex Yoga Array, the vast array of help. We've got a toehold. We have some momentum. So it's not been a wasted month. I was getting worried, really. I was getting really quite worried because it felt like we're behind. So I felt like we're behind. So I needed to catch up and up our game. Had to up the game here, and fortunately it happened. Barely, but it, you know, right just at the nick of time, it happened. But that's often desperation. It's usually the last moment we decide, wow, can't procrastinate any longer. So we now have Apex Yoga Intensive here. An Apex Yoga Intensive with some momentum underway. There's a little bit of momentum, a little trickle of momentum going here. So it's like water in a desert. There's some water in the desert. And we say, hey, where's that water coming from? Really, like in the desert, there's these gullies, and they're dry usually. And imagine if you're sitting there and you say, wow, there's no water, everything's so parched. We're all going to starve to death. This is horrible. Nothing to cool down, nothing to drink. You're thinking it's all over for you, and then you're staring at the gully, and then you see this little tiny stream of water trickling through the gully. It might be an inch wide. And you just say, am I dreaming? Must be dreaming. That's not possible. Someone's playing a trick on me. How's this possible? What's going on? You get that little stream of water, little trickle, little tiny trickle of water. An inch wide, goes past you, continues on, and then it continues, gets a little wider, and you're just saying, what is this? Is this some kind of miracle, or what's going, you know, don't pinch me, I don't want to wake up from this beautiful dream, I see a tiny little bit of water in the desert. Well, what happened is, way up in the mountains, maybe 50, 60, 70 miles away, there's been tremendous rain falling, and it's been coming down the hillsides, and a lot of it sinks into sand, but it's been such a great rain that now you're seeing the first trickle as coming through where you are, and you're thinking, maybe there's more to come, maybe there's more to come. And it's the most beautiful sight to see this water in a parched land. So it's one little meditation, but that's coming from a massive amount of push from the apex array. A massive push. So in my little desert gully, I've got a little stream going now. It's like, ah, wow. We might gather a little bit in a cup or something, and maybe plant a little seed, some flower seeds, in the bare, parched area where we're staying. Nothing's growing because it's been such a drought. We plant a bunch of little impatient seeds or something, and start watering them just a little bit each day like this. And before you know it, flowers are growing around your house again. Yeah, like that. That'd be a nice thing here. We don't have any flowers growing here at all. They're all because of the drought. Let everything die. And you can have some water. You start drinking a little bit of water, watering the flowers, watering a few plants. Start watering them. Bringing some greenery back, some lushness back into your life, some beauty and lushness back into your life. Just from that little tiny stream that's coming. Might as well, huh? You might dig a little pond, a little area that so it fills up so you can scoop some water out of it. The apex array. Showing up here. Showing up here. As they promised they would. As they promised they would. So this may be the opportune moment, this 1 month after 1 month of the new U.S. presidency, which is stirring up great consternation. And it's all good. It's all good. I likened it yesterday. I made this comment. I said, the new president is like a therapist for all the liberals, basically. He's their therapist. So they now have therapy. A wonderful therapist, actually. He's a very good therapist for them. Perfect, perfect. They get to go into therapy, but therapy is a rocky road. All the projections are flying like crazy. You know, you're mentally ill. You're this. You're that. And those are all projections. In other words, they have to now go through therapy to face their own mental illness, and their own bizarre distortions and lies and everything they've been engaged in for so long, and no one called them on it. They could get away with it, and now they have a therapist. They can't get away with it anymore. The therapist kind of says, "No, it's you're the one. You're the one who has the trouble. So let's look at that. Let's deal." It's not working for them anymore, which is great for them. They may not think that way right now, but it is wonderful for them. Very happy for them. They got this wonderful therapist who just won't, refuses to accept their projections. He says, no, that's your projection. That's what a therapist does. I mean, a really good therapist, there's certain people who are good therapists, and they just say, no, that's your stuff. You're trying to push your stuff onto me, and that's not my stuff, that's your stuff. You have to look at that. That's coming from you. And of course, those who are skilled in projection, they keep, no, you're crazy, you're mentally ill, you're a liar, you're a terrible therapist, what are you talking about, give me my money back. And they just on and on and on and on and on with this complaints and stuff. But a good therapist just, they've heard it all before, the complainers, and they don't bend. That's a great therapist. So it's therapy time for the liberals. I don't need therapy, I've already been through it. So for me, I don't really have any interest in the president because, I don't need therapy. So I don't need to follow the drama of the therapy at all. It doesn't interest me. The therapy of the liberals, they'll get great therapy and they'll get better, which is wonderful. They desperately, desperately need it. It was the best thing that ever happened to them. In hindsight, they'll look back at it in that way. The best thing that ever happened to them. They got to make a start. They got to make a start. But again, for me, I'm not going to go there at all. Or follow how it goes. It doesn't interest me. I've already been through all my therapy, and so that's been there, done that. And let those who are in therapy, let them share their sob stories with one another. And you hear what he said today? I can't believe what he said. He's crazy. He's mentally ill. He says, we got to stop. But we're going to survive this? All this kind of stuff. When you're in therapy, it's like, it's tumultuous. It's tumultuous. Your storylines aren't working anymore. And it's like, so that's what they're into. We'll stay out of that. Because we have something, way bigger, way bigger, way more important. We have the super therapists. We're working with the super therapists now, Longchenpa, the Apex Array super therapists. that show us how to be liberated from all troubles, from all affliction, from the entire ocean of doubt. It's a shift in therapy. Instead of just trying to trade one doubt story for another, we see them all as the same. No truth to any of them, no meaning. They're all meaningless. They all have no value, zero value. And so we're in a position to be liberated. True liberation. The apex array is all about true liberation. So we're doing that. And that doesn't really have anything to do with what the liberals and the president are doing, that therapy story. That's kindergarten, but it's a start. You start to realize, maybe we didn't have all the answers. Maybe we aren't. Maybe we have some problems of our own. Is that possible? Is that possible? Like, we might be mistaken? Yeah. Maybe. Yeah. Maybe we don't have all the answers. Oh, our gods have failed us. Our cleverness has failed us. Our lies have been seen through. All this stuff is like, oh my gosh, what do we do? What do we do? What do we do? And it causes introspection to start taking place, and for many, if they take it in the right way, the academic game is not working anymore. All the games that they've been playing, they're just not working anymore. And they never had any chance of working in the first place. But now, they're seeing it in a strong way, which is helpful. So they can back off and say, "Wow, this stuff doesn't work. What works?" And they might start asking the question, "Well, what works? What really works?" So that starts this dim process of searching for what the answer really is. It's vague, it's very blurry and very vague at first, but, a step journey of 1,000 miles starts with the first step. So they've taken the first step, and they're all into it, trying to get more propaganda to prop their positions up, and more lies and made-up stuff, and it's ridiculous. It's so ridiculous. If they only could see how ridiculous it is, they'd have a good laugh at it. But right now, it's their storyline, and it's not working well. So, they're going to have quite a fun time, though. Really have quite a fun time. It's going to be quite a circus. Here come the winds. Here it comes. It's picking up now. It's picking up. It means that the pressure front is preceding the rain is starting to move toward us. Yeah, you can tell the weather how it goes, just like you could tell the world how it goes. But we're going to do our thing, which is apex yoga. Okay, we're going to do apex yoga. We're going to do apex yoga, and that's it. That's all we're doing. That's all we're doing. We're just doing apex yoga here. We're not going to graft it into something else so much, really. We're going to be very strict, and not play around with it, get foolish about it. When we get desperate, people get desperate, it tends to bring out the best in us. In some of us, it brings out the worst, some of it brings out the best. But if you're prepared, it brings out the best, and you get strict with yourself and say, enough of this foolishness. You be humble, you be strict, you don't get silly, you stay disciplined. We're not dragging some other kind of yoga into this, okay? It's just apex yoga. That's it. That's what we do here. That's water in a desert. It's not Buddhism. It's not Christianity. It's not any of this other stuff. It's apex yoga. It's not even A Course in Miracles. We're going to keep it really very simple. Very, very simple. Very, very simple. I am an apex yogin. Wow. I would say this is the most important practice to use. I am an apex yogini. Wow. Just say that and say it and say it and say it and say it and say it. It's really that simple. I've been doing this for a while. I am apex yoga. Wow. I am an apex yogin. Wow. So I've been doing it for, I don't know, a couple weeks or so. I've been getting moving into that. I am an apex yogin. Wow. I am an apex yogin. Wow. So apex yoga is all about doing it, not about saying, let's do comparative philosophy, comparative theology. How does this compare? We don't do any of that. We just practice what we're called to practice here. That's it. I am an apex yogin. Wow. So this is a culture here of practicing, of successful practicing, of actually doing it. That's rare. It's very rare in this world. But I would say the times are desperate enough where it's absolutely called for. And nothing else is called for. I cannot condone anything else, really. I cannot at this point. But this was all anticipated, pre-anticipated. I knew these times were coming, and they're here now. But at least, you know, I'm prepared. That means, by extension, this helps others who want to do it. It's encouraging for them. It's encouraging for them. There's a culture of encouragement. So apex yoga is the name we're giving to it. Apex yoga. Apex yoga. And the apex yoga array is all the Dharma kings, all those who taught in this way. Ram Maharshi, for instance, was absolutely taught apex yoga. He was absolutely spot on in his focus for us. Okay, absolutely. Dharma King. So that's the array that's in support of us. That's very much in support of us. Ramana is very much in support of this. He gave me a sign. It was an extraordinary sign. I had been doing this yesterday as I was taking naps. I was trying this practice, and I woke up from a nap, and I looked at the computer, and there was a picture of Ram Maharshi on my computer, but the light bulb in the room was reflected, the bulb itself, and the bulb was exactly superimposed upon his head. So he had the Ramana's body and then a head of just brilliant white light. That's what I was seeing on the computer when I woke up and looked at it. That happened twice. I said, oh my gosh. And so I was looking at it, I was looking at the light, and I didn't say, where's Ramana's head, where's his head? No, I said, no, that is his head, the light itself, that is what we are. You talk about Ramana again helping out. He's indescribably supportive. As is Anandamayi Ma. Had a dream of her, not last night, the night before. It had to be her. It was a little girl. I don't know, 8-year-old or something. Not older, you know, just. Yeah, about like an 8-year-old. And I went to this shack this airport, it seemed like it'd be an airport. It was full of these spare parts or for airplanes, aluminum fuselages or fuel tanks or something. Thousands and thousands and thousands just lined up in this airport area. And I don't know if it was the desert, maybe where they store the airplane parts or something. It could have been. But there's a shack, a little tiny pay shack or something, to get into the airport or whatever. I stopped, and there's a little girl there, and she said, yeah. And I said, here, can you give me some change? And gave her some money. She goes, I gave her some money or something. And then she goes, okay, here's your change. And then she kind of like tossed it to me in a certain way, and it all fell to the ground. All my change was on the ground, But I didn't get upset. I just said, oh, huh, okay. And then she walked off talking with some other little children, and she was so blissfully happy. You know, just this blissful young little girl, 8-year-old or something, just, you know, just absolutely bubbling over with happiness and you know, beautiful spirits. And I thought, what was that? Well, the change that's going to happen, change is on the ground. She said, here's your change. I'm giving you change now. And the change is on the ground. Something to do with, is going to be grounded here. It's going to be grounded here somehow. The change is actually going to take place here. Very, very profound. Very profound, to say the least. Maybe the very ground that we walk upon is going to feel different to us, appear different to us. You know, the transformation, the change in how we see the world. That's how I took it. It's going to be a literal change in how we experience and see the world. Look out in your dreams for that little girl. That's Anana Maima. The one who acts and who's so happy and so fluid in their motions and so decisive. And then once they're done what they do, they walk off, and it's just, you say, what was that? What was that? There was no like adult consciousness, no storyline consciousness in this little girl at all. No storyline of this world, like, oh, I need to grow up and be an adult, you know, and follow some storyline. None of that. It was not present at all. Buddhist was as Vajra Yogini. Absolutely, absolutely. The diamond-hearted Yogini. The apex yogini, for sure. No storylines here in the world. So she appears as this little girl before, you know, any storylines have really taken root. Just blithely carefree, so blithely carefree, so nimble and spry and blithely carefree, and just bubbling over with exuding this just happiness, you know, exuding it. It's like, wow, you know, in other words, the world hadn't even touched her yet. Untouched. I mean, give children that slack, a little bit of slack like that, right? Not these days. We get them going at daycare and then preschool, you know, as quickly as possible. Pre-preschool, there's even now pre-preschool. So basically being educated into some storyline the minute they get here. But it used to be we let the kids be kids. So we have the little girl, Sri Sri Anana Maima, backing us up, supporting us indescribably in support. She absolutely is taking, you know, tremendous steps to help us. And she always told us, see her as a little girl. And that's exactly how she shows up now in my dreams. No storyline whatsoever with this world or any world. Already pre-arrived, totally pre-arrived. Wherever she is, she's pre-arrived. Whatever she's doing, it's already pre-arrived. With a laugh, you know, just... And I wasn't expecting it in the dream, so I didn't quite get it until I started walking away and said, wait a minute. Is that, you know, what just happened here? So great stuff, great stuff. Jesus showed up in a dream of helping me finish this, getting to land from the ocean of samsara. He was the boatman that was helping me step ashore. So these Dharma kings are showing up, aren't they? They most certainly are. So we have some momentum. We have some momentum. And so, you know, don't panic and don't go frantically trying to satisfy all the storylines or find 100 different teachers or satisfy their what they're about and everything. We have a little momentum here. Dharma King momentum. Apex Array momentum. Manjushri momentum, you might say. One way to describe the apex array is Manjushri. That's a term that really applies to the entire array. So we have Manjushri momentum. The sort of archetypal bodhisattva. The archetypal bodhisattva. But it really, I think, is a way of determining this the whole array. The whole apex array, the entire apex array. We have Manjushri momentum right now. And the absolute, you know, experts like Longchenpa, Padmasambhava, as far as meditation, are helping us out. And it's so simple. We think it's all complicated. No. I am an apex yogin. Wow. It's just doing it and doing it long enough, committing to the long enough periods where you experience the backlash from the ego, from doubt, and it's like, wow, how amazing the mind, our imagination is, how amazing, how subtly clever. It's insidiously clever. You don't even know. And suddenly you're wrapped up in its embrace again. And you don't even know how it happened. You know, just what? The rug is pulled out from underneath you. So quickly. You just go right back. I am an apex yogin. Wow. That's all I have to say. That's my only reaction. That's all I have to say. That's it. I am an apex yogin. Wow. So if you are gravitating towards apex yoga, then forget all this other stuff. It's not your thing. That you've done your therapy. You've done enough therapy. You don't need the therapy coming from the world, you know, worldly therapy. You need Dharma King therapy now. You just have to decide which one do you need. Don't try to do both. That's going to really overwhelm you. You can't really do both. That's why I have to be very strict here. If you try to do both, you'll do both badly and be overwhelmed by it. So if you still need the worldly therapy, then just do the worldly therapy until you've had enough of it. And if you feel like, you know, I've had enough of the worldly therapy. I really want Dharma King therapy. Then just decide, okay, that's what I'm going to be do. That's what I'm going to do. That's what I'm going to be and do. Be do. It's a nice word, be do. Be and do. I be doing it. And, you know, some people are going to do pet therapy. That's another lot of, I mean, a massive amount of people are thinking, pet therapy. And that's a type of therapy too, which is fine. But if you do pet therapy, okay, that's not Dharma King therapy. So you have to also decide, am I going to do pet therapy or Dharma King therapy? I remember my cat getting cancer and leaving me. I spent about a month talking with it. Every night I come in and say, hey, you know you don't have to die. You could easily get well. And the cat would like, yeah, I know what you're saying. You're right. But he says, it's time for you to take the next step, Dharma King therapy. Okay? I helped get you to this point, and now it's time for you to go on and focus in, and it's enough of animals, okay? That's enough. And he gave us the feeling that after his passing away, we don't want any more animals. We're not going to get anything close to what that cat was. No way. It's not possible, really. It's not possible. So we realized that's it. That's it. So pet therapy only takes you so far. It's not far enough at all. It just kind of, in a lot of people, it's a way of not having therapy. You know, it's might even be better to engage with the therapy of the world and struggle with it rather than just retreat and say, oh, here's my pet. Let me just hold on to my little dog, you know, I'll take my dog for a walk and I'll hold on to my dog and that's it. That is a way maybe of avoiding therapy, avoiding it. Just say, no, the cat, let me just pet the cat here and just say, okay, I'll be okay. But, you know, maybe for some it might help a little bit. But whichever way you look at it, Dharma King therapy is not pet therapy, okay? Not at all. You don't see in sure, Ramana had some animals around the ashram. Okay, that's a whole different story. That's an entirely different story. But if you look at Tibetan practitioners, you don't see them like with all their animals and in their caves and meditate. You don't see that in throughout history. You don't see pets being central to people's well-being. This is ridiculous. Every day people come up to me and say, oh, we just ordered a new animal from somewhere, some custom hybrid animal. Yeah, we're really looking forward to living our lives with this animal. It's really going to help us. You know, they think that's the answer because they don't have any other answer. They think, I just need to learn how to be a better animal. You know, my storyline's not working because I'm still have some delusions of spirituality in my mind. So this animal's going to help me realize I'm just really a human animal and learn how to be happy with that. That's what they're after. That's what they're, most of them are after that. Do they think that patterning their life after animals is going to liberate them from their spiritual pretensions? Because they believe spiritual belief is all just dangerous pretension that's getting in the way of their happiness. This is the liberal attitude, humanistic, liberal, materialistic attitude. That's what they believe, that the spiritual dimension we have, which is what we really are, is some sort of dangerous mental illness, but they're the ones who are getting well because they're getting away from it. They're finally freeing themselves from that, so they think they're getting well. And the ones who still have some of that belief, they think that they're mentally ill. That's how they actually believe. It's like upside down and backwards. So animals help them feel more animalistic, which is what they're trying to do. This is what I've experienced in my life, and this is what I see without question. It's like that. Now, there are all sorts of variations, of course. Every situation is unique. All right. So, in some cases, it can be helpful. In some cases, it can. I don't want to, make it completely cut and dried. But generally speaking, really, it's best to turn your attention away from animals. The world is becoming obsessed with animals as it tries to abandon God, tries to abandon the spiritual truth of what we are, becomes obsessed with animals. For me, I'm really not obsessed with animals. I don't even think about animals just anymore. Animals, nature, all stuff, just not important. It doesn't mean I'm not kind. I'm super kind to animals. Always have been. To everything. Even an ant, mosquito, you name it. But I'm not, this ridiculous obsession. It's just like a jade. You don't kill, try not to harm anything here. Don't kill anything. Don't harm anything. Just like that. But I'm not fixated on any of it. And you know what? The animals appreciate it. Because they realize there is, spirit is truth. I mean, what are you doing trying to be like an animal? That's stupid. That's really stupid. Really stupid. So this is an extreme trend in the world right now. An extreme trend, and a very bad one. Avoid it, if at all possible. Thank God I have the excuses of avoiding that. Because I always had animals. I grew up with animals. And actually, looking back, it was a negative influence on my life. Very, very negative influence. Very bad. It is a way to lure me away from my spiritual clarity. Thinking that animals were so cool. Being an animal is so cool. They're trying to teach us that being a human animal is where it's at. Right? A human animal. They actually talk this way. It's so funny listening to them. I go on the internet and listen to comments of people around these issues. And it's just, I'm just like astonished, by the way they talk. The human animal, what? The human animal. These scientific types, they just crack me up. They really do. The human animal. The species, the human species, one of many animal species in the world, but certainly not the best species in the world. Dogs are actually much more evolved species. Look at the way they act, or this species and having, it's like, they're living in the dark ages, it's comedy. If it wasn't so sad, it would be hilarious. And so they're trying to equate their mind with an animal mind so they can avoid. They think that the storyline of doubt they're on, this will work. If I just go with it and make the most of it and I believe I'm a human animal and I'm, I can't, no spiritual side to me, that should ease my doubts. Ease my doubts. Because doubt feels threatened by reality. So the way they think that to ease their doubts, they just said, let me just fixate on doubt, to the ultimate extent, and then maybe reality won't bother me anymore. It doesn't work that way. Ultimately, you go to mental chaos, hoping that that'll get rid of reality, and it doesn't. So we don't indulge animals here, okay? This is a strict, Apex Yoga is very strict about that. It's not about personalities. It's not about human animals. It's not about animal animals. It's not about politics. It's not about social issues. It's not about any. It's about skillful practice. So that's all it's about. Skillful practice. That's all that it's about. Skillful practice. That's all that it's about. And faith, 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 faith. in the Apex Array and the Dharma Kings. The Dharma Kings in the Apex Array, the Manjushri momentum. Having faith in that. And saying, I am an Apex Yogin. Wow. That's your identity. That's your true identity. I'm an Apex Yogin. That's my identity. I'm not a human being. I'm an Apex Yogin. Okay, I'm an Apex Yogin. That's what I am, because I'm practicing. I'm practicing the Apex way. Pulling up doubt from the roots. The whole tree is uprooted this way. The whole tree of doubt is uprooted. That's the only way that ultimately will work. Yeah, it's great when you realize nobody loves me. You know, nobody. Wow. Okay. Hey, Longchenpa. What do I do? Well, the Dharma Kings love us. So turn to them for answers. Whereas if you have a little dog, it's like nobody loves me except my little dog loves me so much. They just sit and look at me like, good Lord, it's pathetic. I'm sorry. It is. I know it backwards and forwards. It ultimately you realize dogs are pathetic. They're pathetic. You get so bored of them, so tired of them. That dependence kind of looking at you like, oh, you're God to me. You're God to me. You're God to me. You just a, you know, it becomes tiresome at some point. You just, wow, I'm so tired of that. Go fetch the ball. Oh, it comes back. Fetch the ball. Okay. It's so mundane and pathetic at some point. And so if you get that, you realize, yeah, it doesn't literally lead anywhere at all. It's not what we're cut out for at all. We're cut out for Apex Yoga, actually. All of us are. All of us are. That's what we're really cut out for. We're cut out for realizing we're all pre-arrived everywhere. Everything is everything. All is all, and all is all pre-arrived everywhere. And there can never be any doubt whatsoever. And we can never be defined in any way. We're absolutely free. And nothing has ever happened in terms of doubt. It's never happened. And there's never any regrets. We're formless, absolutely formless. All of this ultimately will be realized. That's what we're all cut out for, because that's what we are already are. We can't escape it. It's inescapably true. Doubt does not cause us to escape facts. It just causes us to doubt facts. It doesn't enable us to escape them. Now, see, Jesus loves us, but he challenges us. Does a dog challenge us the way Jesus does? Jesus says, look, this is why I love you. But your belief system, you got to change your belief systems, because your belief system of doubt will never work. And this is why it won't work. And see, this then engages us. We have to actually work at it. We just can't give the pooch a little treat, and then the pooch loves us. They go, oh, look how much the pooch loves us. I'm such a wonderful person. The dog depends on me to feed them. And if I didn't feed them, they'd die. So I'm really doing such a great thing for the dog. The dog loves me so much for it. I'm so such a lovable person, even though I'm, extremely cuckoo. I could be on a severe doubt trip. But where the Apex Array challenges us to really consider. Wow, reconsider, and say maybe we're mistaken, maybe we've been making mistakes. So it engages reason within us, engages reason and glimpses of experiencing, and engages the totality of what we are. So we have to mobilize our real capacity to get with it. Or you don't have to mobilize your capacity to feed your little poodle, you know, or whatever, right? Or if you're blue collar, you probably have a pit bull, right? Keep the pit bull. Here you go, pit bull. A little scrap. Oh, thank you. You know, oh, I'm such a wonderful person. Look. I'm feeding the animal. It doesn't mobilize anything in us hardly at all, right? Hardly at all. So that to be challenged, so that you mobilize your real capacities, that's what we're called to here. That's what we're called to here. They're trying to get animals into church now. This is going back and forth. Ultimately, I'm sure they will. Everybody will bring their pet to church with them. Well, because God loves animals too. You know, God. It's really a screwy thing going on. Really a screwy thing. And it's hard to combat, you know, the way they present it. It's always difficult to combat insanity because it's so defended. We're called, and we go to church, a place of worship, we're called to mobilize the totality of our capacity and to stop leaning on the crutch of animals for a little while, and drugs and everything that we lean on, the instant gratifications that we're used to leaning on. We're called to start realizing, hey, we got a long, tough path here, and instant gratification is not where it's at. It's the virtues of patience and humility and all this stuff. That's what we have to employ. We have to bring totality of our capability to bear upon this problem we have. Otherwise, we'll continue to flounder with some, you know, in the storylines of doubt, the ocean of samsara, maya, illusion, hell, really. So it's all about getting away from your crutches for a little while. That's what it's about. So you don't invite the crutches in. You know, pretty soon they'll have animals and people smoking crack cocaine in church. Rock and roll and sex, drugs, animals, the whole thing. The whole circus will be in town. And they'll say, okay, we finally got it. We finally got church the way we like it. It's all about getting away from your crutches so you feel desperate enough to call upon that, let that desperation turn you towards God. And then you'll see that God's calling upon you to use skillful means. Just like my extreme desperation yesterday, I took it in the right way and said, okay, don't let me lean on any crutches here. Let me just sit in the chair and just say, okay, I'm at the end of my rope, so what's here at the end of the rope? I tried to do a few things, but the computer froze up and God kept blocking everything. I said, maybe I'll listen to a bunch of disco music and start dancing. No, you're too sick for that. Don't do that. And then I heard what needed to be done and said, okay, let me try it. I've not really tried it to the ultimate extent I need to. That's a perfect example of what the spiritual path, what worship, church, all this stuff is supposed to be for you. Blessed are the poor in spirit, the desperate. Blessed are the desperate, Jesus said. Those are the ones that are going to succeed. So church is all about the desperate saying, we're willing to turn towards skillful means now because we're desperate. And we're willing to put aside those crutches because we know that those don't work. We know they don't work. It's not about being a good person. It's about getting down to the work that needs to be done. And it's often said people don't really start making progress until they bottom out, hit bottom. Well, I hit bottom yesterday, and look what happened. It seems like every day, though, is bottom for me. So, you know, it's just getting pushed. You don't want things to be too nice and easy in this world, for the most part. That's not very helpful for us. Everybody's frantically trying to avoid being, you know, galvanized into turning in the right direction. They just, you know, they're so fearful that they'll be overwhelmed. But you go a little bit at a time. It doesn't really become overwhelming. But you do, it does seem like difficult work. You know, we're so lazy and out of shape, you know, it's just like we just procrastinate, thinking, that's too tough, that'll be too tough, I don't want to do that. That's easy. I mean, this, I enjoyed it, what I did. I said, wow, this is a blast, I love doing this, this is great. But in my mind, it was like, oh, that's going to be so difficult. There's only the last recourse, the last thing I possibly do on earth, you know. And yet it wasn't difficult at all. It's the ego that says it's difficult. The ego says, that's too difficult for me. I won't be able to give you a doubt path, you know. I can't fake it. You know, so it's the ego that's claiming it's difficult on the ego. Well, that's fine. We don't need it to be easy for the ego. It just can't sell us on some doubt path, that's all. The ego says, well, I'm failing to sell you on a doubt path. Well, that's okay. I don't need it. I don't need it. I am an apex yogin. Wow. I don't need a doubt path. I never have needed it. No one needs it. So it's okay for the ego to fail, to sell us on a doubt path. That's okay. It keeps trying. Until we just ultimately lose interest in it so much so that it says, that's okay, ego. We don't even need any more doubt paths. And of course, the ego is just our own arrogance expressing itself and trying to throw doubt upon ourselves, and so there isn't any really other self there. Just when we lose interest in it, it dwindles away and then just kind of dissolves and doesn't arise anymore to tempt us, that's all. Yeah, you can feel, I mean, this is pushing in, this storm. Wow. The air just feels very full of moisture, cold, full of moisture, and it's fun. It's an event still. I thought I'd never see it rain again in California. It's like, wow, it may never happen again. So this is just wonderful. It's raining. What is this? Look at that. It's so beautiful. Now, the doubt paths that the ego give rise to are very creative and beautiful. I mean, it just is very sublime, all the tricks that it's using. So it's not like you're destitute. I mean, the whole thing is pretty interesting. It's like a circus. It's throwing this circus, a massive circus of, and you're just sticking with I am an apex yogin. Wow. So beautiful aesthetics are not a substitute for meditation. They're not a substitute for it. I've backed away from beautiful aesthetics for now. I don't know if I'll go, you know, post some more for people or not. I don't know. I have a lot of, you know, video, a lot of great stuff, and I could always get more. You know, I'm good at it, but it's this meditation is where it's at. And the simplicity, accepting the simplicity of your path, it is very simple. That's all that I did, just I am an apex yogin, wow, that's it. And I was able to experience the whole picture of meditation, what it's really about. That's all I needed, that's it. It's free, isn't it, in terms of doesn't cost anything for you to say, I'm an apex yogin, wow, and keep repeating it, repeating it, repeating it, stringing it together. You don't even need a mala to do it, right? Forget about all that stuff. That's a side trip. I got to keep track. I did it. How many times I do it? Don't keep track of how many times you do it. You're just going to keep doing it. That's all. The challenge is to just don't stop and just keep doing it all night or as long as you can. Don't ever count how many times you're doing it. That is not it at all. Because then you just simply have a goal to reach, and it completely alters the whole thing. The whole purpose of it is that this is what I'm saying. This is my position, and I'm not changing it. And I'm just going to keep repeating it. That's it. That's what really digs into your whole psyche. Whereas if you say, I'm going to do it like 50,000 times, then you're just trying to reach a number. And it's just, that's just mechanical at that point. Don't ever put a time limit on it or a number limit on it. Don't count the time and don't count any numbers. Refuse to do that at all. This heat pad is not so hot anymore. Yeah. Okay, so that's a very important point. We do not keep track of how long. I wasn't keeping track. I said, I'm doing it all night. And who knows after that, you know. At least I'm going to do it all night. If I wake up, I'll keep doing it. If I go to sleep and I wake up, I'll just keep doing it. And the numbers I have no idea, I could care less. Whether it's one time or a trillion times, makes no difference. I'm just going to keep doing it, that's all. So this is very important to hear this. We will not get into any time limit frames, not try to specify too much time frames, or certainly not specifying any numbers at all. That's an absolute no-no. Then you get competition. Well, I did it this long, or I did this number of stuff. That's juvenile, totally juvenile. And that's not apex yoga at all. It's more like a gunslingers, you know, at high noon. It's like saying, this is the showdown, and we're going to see who's standing after the showdown is done. So that's more like that. It says, This is where what I'm going to do, and I'm going to do it, and you're going to try to stop me from doing it, and we'll see who's standing at the end. It's all in type of thing. It's that feeling. So remove the fixation from your mind of a performance. Okay, a performance. It's way more desperate than that. It's a determination, it's a steady determination of applying skillful means, a steady determination. It's like an all-in sort of thing. You're all-in. There's no turning back. You're all-in, there's no turning back. It's like you're setting out on this voyage or something, or you're setting out, and it's just, I'm all-in. And how can you be all in if you say, well, I'm going to do it for like an hour, or I'm going to do it like 6,000 times. I'll say it 1,000 times, and then I'll stop. You know, you already have an out for yourself. That's not all in. I mean, I just did it as long as I could do it, and ultimately I had to get out of bed. But if I was still in bed, I'd still be doing it. I woke up, I felt like enough, you know, energy to get up and eat and stuff. Otherwise, I'd still be doing it. So it's way better to go into it open-ended. And we're not saying how long you should do it either way, or how much you should do it either way. It's just open-ended. Open-ended. And that's what scares the ego. That's what gets the ego jittery. And then you start experiencing its resistance. So it's all about experiencing the resistance that's there, noticing it, and saying, wow. And every single one of those tricks the ego was playing on me was trying to pull me into another lifetime. You know that? Or many lifetimes. Storyline of doubt. Every one of those tricks was trying to wrap me up in a cocoon of delusional doubt. And you see that. You say, oh my gosh, that's what's been happening to me for so long. That's exactly what's been happening to me. And that's how I get pulled into another life. And it happens so quickly and easily. So we think we die. That's it. That's just the end of one storyline. All the other storylines are in play. And the ego just easily beguiles us. Our imagination beguiles us into choosing another, you know, before we know it, we've taken another birth. Just like that. Just like that. It's shocking. Shocking. But you become aware of it. You become aware of the resistance and the opposition. And so you know, oh my gosh, it really is like that. Wow. That's horrible. But let me keep working at it then. We can't have this stand. This has to be uprooted. So you might say positive desperation, informed desperation then it becomes, which is great. It provides a great motivator. Okay, so we've reached what, the two minute, yeah, seems like the 2 hour mark here. And before I get overly chilled here, so I can recover and hopefully work tomorrow. Covered a lot of territory here, and hopefully as this year goes on, by the time you reach 218, I'm hoping some of you will be Apex Yogin. Say, I am an Apex Yogin. I already said that. I committed February 13th. I committed to Longchamp. I said, to the Apex Array, I said, I am an Apex Yogin. I'm an Apex Yogin. I just made that declaration. I am an Apex Yogin. And this is how I define myself now. And that puts a big jolt. Just saying that puts a big jolt. You talk about a wow. If you want to know what wow feels like, that just declare it. You're an Apex Yogin. Keep declaring it. And you will feel a reaction to that. For sure. And then you'll say, oh, so this is what the wow's about. This is what the shock's about. Wow. Because I just felt a tremendous jolt just saying that. So by February 13th, I'll say, of 2018, we'll give you a little leeway there. You want to be able to say that. I am an Apex Yogin. You want to be able to say that. Because that puts you in the driver's seat. Really puts you in the driver's seat. So just keep on in the intensive here. Just keep on. I don't know how to present the intensive exactly. Everybody's all over the map these days. But it's a pre-intensive. So allow yourself to be blocked in certain ways. Accept it with grace. Keep listening. Keep practicing. Keep doing everything you can do. And try to say that as much as possible. I am an Apex Yogin. And be desperate, because it is desperate right now. It is feeling desperate is not a bad. It's that's just being in tune with what's going on. It's really desperate, because those in therapy want you to support them and tell them that they don't need to be in therapy, right? They want to say no, you know, we don't have any troubles. It's all their fault. And you need to support us so that, whoa, in other words, you need to agree that being this way is no trouble at all. No, it's vastly problematical. So you don't want to get sucked into that, the maw of that madness. You want to be saying, look, I know I've got a tremendous amount of troubles and problems. I'm really messed up. I'm on this, you know, lost in this ocean of samsara and just desperately trying to get free of it. And you know, I think each one of us we're all messed up. So let's. I'm not into scapegoating at all. I just don't. I don't go there. I just work on myself and advise everyone else to work on their themselves and not project blame and attack others in any way, and just keep focusing on our doubt trip that we're on. Okay. You need to be like that so you don't get sucked into it. You know, the polarization thing. I am an apex yogin. I am an apex yogin. Okay. Don't worry about those who say, well, what do you mean I? Those are posers. Okay, they're posers. Okay, we're practicing. We're not posers, we're practicers here. Totally different sort of thing. Totally different. Totally different. It's perfectly okay to use the term I. We're just referring to identity, okay? It's just a term that refers to identity. And we say, I am an apex yogin. This is the identity I'm choosing for myself right now. I'm choosing this as a pragmatic, I'm a practicer, okay? I'm a yogin, I'm a practicer of apex yoga. That's what I'm about. So don't even give any thought to those who play these silly, you know, word games. I, you know, who's I? What do you mean I? You know, this kind of stuff. Let them do their way, if that's their way, and maybe they can use it to be their way. We don't need that way. We don't need that way. It's perfectly fine to say I am an apex yogin. That's fine. The identity of my being is that is an apex yogin, because this will help me reveal my true identity. So of course, for the purposes of speech, we can use the term I. It's perfectly fine. But you can say it. It's great as you're driving to say, I am an apex yogin. As you're working, I am an apex yogin. Wow. I am an apex yogin. Wow. As you're working, as you're driving, as you're talking with people, as you meet someone, you're talking, just remind yourself, I am an apex yogin. Because otherwise they'll project their own problems and identity of doubt upon you and say, you're a doubter. See, I'm right, but you're a doubter. Everyone is projecting. They're into projection now to an extreme extent. The liberals, that's what their stock and trade is projection. Projection, projection, projection. And they just think they're better at it than others. So excuses their projection. You know, and so it doesn't. you're interacting with people. Everyone is so much into projection. Those who aren't, you feel it. And you feel more comfortable. You say, wow. Here's someone who's humble, who's admitting to their own mistakes, and they'll say, "Look, I'm the first to admit I am not such a nice person, and I got a lot of problems, and I judge other people too much, and I struggle with all this kind of stuff." Then you feel like heart to heart, you know, and I say, "Yeah, I'm the same way," and so we're real. We're real. So you can feel that. If someone's real, you feel that. Whereas if someone's not real and they're just projecting upon you that you're full of doubts, but they're certain, if that's what's happening, then you need to remind yourself, I am an apex yogin. Wow. I am an apex yogin. Wow. Now I need to practice this, because every time I talk with people, I end up slipping down and accepting some doubt trip. I start doubting I'm an apex yogin. It's amazing. So it's very good. You could just silently practice this during the day. Silently practice this during the day. I am an apex yogin. Silently practice during the day. In every circumstance you can, that comes up. As you're walking along, as you're eating, I am an apex yogin. Wow. And just jolt yourself with this as often as possible. This is the pre-intensive. So we have the pre-intensive. It's very simple. I am an apex yogin. Now, Anandamayi is absolutely working behind the scenes, as is Jesus Christ, as Ramaharshi, Jamyang Kenshi Chogyi Lodro, Padmasambhava, the Manjushri Array, the Manjushri Momentum, the Apex Array, is absolutely working to an extraordinary extent. So we don't know how this is going to play out in 218, for instance. but it's bound to get better and better. It's bound to get better and better. The amount of water that's flowing is bound to get more and more and more, which means we can water more flowers, more fruits, more lushness, right? More spiritual lushness in our lives. It's bound to be that way. So we better prepare for that. We better prepare for that. It's going to get better and better and better. And so we have this super effective, super simple way of preparing. I am an apex yogin. We don't need to say it out loud to people. We don't need to be in their faces. But just say it to yourself and just more and more just feel it. Just feel it. Be shocked by it and feel it. I am an apex yogin. Wow. Claim that identity, because the world won't give that identity to you. They will not. They will give you a doubt-based identity that makes themselves feel superior to you. This is what's going on in the world. So, don't think you can come across this in the world and people want you to be this way. They don't. They don't want you to be this way. They want you to be full of doubt as well. They want you to be full of doubt. They want you to accept their projections. They want you to feel guilty and all this kind of nonsense. But so you have to hear it here, coming from the apex array. And you have to practice it yourself. You won't, others will not really encourage you to do that. Don't ask them about it, okay? They might say, yeah, that's nice, but then they'll start subverting it. You just keep it to yourself. I am an apex yogin. Wow, that's my identity. You're choosing this identity of yourself as a pragmatic identity for right now. That's where it's at. I am an apex yogin or yogini. Wow. Okay, just say, I am an apex yogin. Keep it simple. You can say that. Male or female can say that. And if you're female and you want to say yogini, same thing. All right, same thing. No troubles. But just say that. I am an apex yogin. Wow. I am an apex yogin. Wow. Yogin, just one who practices yoga. Just a neutral term. One who practices which true yoga. Apex yoga is true yoga. True meditation. True effective means. Coming from the highest adepts. Longchenpa is unsurpassed adept at all of this. He's not out of his depths anywhere when it comes to meditation. He really specialized in it, in the caves. Spent most of his life in caves, living in caves silently, in silent retreat, meditating. That was his thing. He was that hermit in caves in Tibet. He interacted occasionally, but for the most part, he spent his life in solitary retreat in caves, just in constant meditation and in writing. He could write apparently very fast. It was so easy for him. Just it didn't take him long to write out his clarity. He wrote a lot, published a lot of books, but he spent his life in tremendous retreat in meditation, just being super, super clear and familiar with the apex array of meditation. And you can tell the familiarity he has with it is extraordinary. He speaks as one with vast familiarity. The way he puts together words and expresses it comes from vast familiarity. Of he's saying, okay, I don't want to lose the essence of it here. So how can I put words together so the essence still seems to be there? So he has to be aware of the essence in order to do that. You have to be very familiar with the essence in order to know how not to tamper with it you know, by using words and concepts, how to give minimal tampering to it, requires vast familiarity. So that's why you read Longchamp, but you say, oh my gosh, this someone must have vast familiarity with it. How can he possibly write this way? You know, it strikes you. It's very striking. Same with Jesus in A Course in Miracles. You say, oh my gosh, the writer must have, you know, vast familiarity with what he's speaking of, to be able to craft the words in all this in such a way, in this way. It's striking. So we can say, we can pray to Nan Maima, oh non-storied lined beatitude, give us your blessings every day, you know, like that. We don't have to even use a term, non-storied lined beatitude. Give us your gorgeous blessings every day, your marvelous blessings every day. Now, I've been with Sri Sri Nan Maima for 20 years, and before that she overshadowed my life. I just didn't have a name for her, but 20 years of very intense involvement with her. How many times has she appeared to me in dreams? Just very, very many times. But now we have a way of saying, oh, non-storied line beatitude. Grace us with your, you know, with gorgeous blessings every day. With sublime, with blissful blessings every day. Blissful blessings every day. With your non-storied lined blissful blessings every day. I've been aware, I'm ongoingly aware, she is very, very, very active, just subtly, at least to us it's subtle, but very, very, very active. Push, 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 push. You talk about Johnny on the spot. that's it. That's her trademark. I mean, just at the right moment, the right thing is done. It's like that. So somehow all this is, you know, sort of pushing my illness to the side right now. I'm able to feel this and do all this. And so how, I don't really feel my sickness at this point. It's likely it's time for it to exit. It did its wonderful work. So I thank the illness. Always thank illness when it arrives. Thank you. You're bringing me something very important to look at here. And it'd be a big help for me. And then you get it, you do it, and then it departs from you. It will depart. My bad eyesight, for instance, I was not able to engage the world the way I wanted to with action. So I became a hermit instead. Very helpful. But right now I could use some better eyesight. Maybe it's time for that to exit too. Because it's getting pretty bad, really bad. worrisome. Your afflictions are helpful, worldly afflictions that prevent you from being, from really pursuing your doubt path vigorously. So helpful, so helpful, so helpful. So congratulations, everyone. You might say the first month of this pre-intensive. Maybe you started the 19th. That's a good way to put it, actually. So we've completed 1 month of the pre-intensive. Let's put it that way. Yeah. I could use January 19th at the beginning of this pre-intensive, because that's what I really said. Once the 2 month intensive idea was over, which is really the inauguration day, so it's four, then I decided let's do a 1 year intensive. That's what it was called for. So we finished 1/12, the first month of the pre-intensive, on a super high note, on a super high note, on a super, super encouraging note, full of hope, super hopeful note here. But that was a very tough month, to say the least. I had a real tough time. It was fun. It was a real battle. Glad it's behind us, that's for sure. That is for sure. Don't want to have another one of those months for a while. That really called upon every capacity we had just to get through this month. So, congratulations to everyone for getting through this month. Now we've got some steam, we've got some momentum, we've got some focus, we have some purpose. We're galvanizing it all now. We've got some help is showing up in tremendous ways. So we can say, all right, here comes month two. Let's get started on the second month. Second month, help, help. That's the word for this month is help. Help is arriving. Help is arriving. No doubt about it. Very exciting. Okay, very great. That's it for this one.